It's time for What the Hell! You can chat with us in the Downnet servers in the Rand Radio channel, or check out the webcam at www.randradio.com. And now it's time to check in with the gang on What the Hell!
Hello.
Ow. Oh, don't tell me that hurt your ears.
I just don't like that sound.
It's a pleasant sound.
I can see it hurting James' ears.
Yeah, it was pretty nasty.
No, it doesn't hurt, it's just I really don't like that sound.
Oh, really?
It just causes everything on my insides to just kind of go...
P3 down, homepage down.
This is weird.
Have you tried wiggling the cord?
Check. Who did this? Keep talking. There we go.
Okay.
Hey, everyone.
Hello.
Please bear with us.
Wow, we have
technical
difficulties. Good.
Hey.
Okay, talk.
I'm here. I can
Perfect. Okay, we're all in order now. It goes this way. Great.
Mm-hmm.
You're listening to the What the Hell show, I think, on Rant Radio. We're not quite organized yet. We don't need to hear ourselves.
We're just really
setting up. Okay, first of all, there's DNS problems. So all you lucky listeners out there that are listening to, there we go. Lieutenant Major Zombie is being a very helpful person. Look at that. He has given out the IP addresses for people to listen into. Those are the two working ones. Good job, actually.
Good
Thank you very much.
That's great. Because now Infolute will know.
Is it? Well, maybe Infolute isn't.
You're going to be hearing a lot of possum jokes tonight. Don't ask me to explain it. It's just going to happen.
Oh, I think you're going to rock backwards. If you're going to move that shoulder.
You fellas are just way too amused by that.
More sugar.
So, how are we all doing tonight?
Carbon?
Yes!
We have some bird cookies in the house tonight.
Carbon?
Bird cookies. We're working on getting the third server up.
Bird.
Let's see how many people are actually listening
in.
Just to see if we've got some success. Hopefully my ICQs are going out and people are getting them. And I did give out the wrong IP address. Well, there's some people listening. That's good enough for me. How about you, Paris? Congrats.
Sure.
Good enough. Okay.
Which is Dr. Pepper's mine? What are you doing? Huh?
Mine is the empty one.
Okay. That works.
So it's going to be a little disorganized tonight. I have to get up as if it isn't always.
I know what I am buying this group for.
What is it?
For Christmas. I'm getting them those little...
magnetic name tags?
No, the little...
Too bad they won't stick to
them. Little pan cozies with everybody's name on them.
That would rock.
That's not a bad plan.
Because this group definitely needs help.
Oh, yeah. Some form or another. Can cozies will be a start.
Give everybody a rubber mouth.
That'll help, too. When we can get
a good follow-up.
What would?
Deep psychological therapy would be a good follow-up.
Yeah.
So I guess you won't be able to see the webcam tonight. The problem is the DNS servers. And what DNS does is changes names into numbers. So when you try and type in www.rantradio.com, it won't change it into a number, so your computer can understand it. And you therefore will not get our webpage.
So you can't log on to the webpage right now?
If I found out the number.
You don't know the number.
In order to do a lookup, from the number.
You need
I need DNS working. I don't have my web page memorized. It might be 205, 206, 214.
Why don't you try that?
53.
Why don't you try that?
We could try random numbers until
Let's
we get
Let's try
it.
Random numbers.
Okay, it's 205.206.214.53. And we wait.
It's contacting host.
It's contacting the host. It could be that all of my work is down.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're witnessing a new world.
Well, busy right? morning tomorrow.
Thankfully, not too much goes through my work, except for the DNS. Obviously. Well, let's try the major web page. Oh, got contacted.
It's waiting for a reply.
Something bad is happening at
isn't
work.
This, isn't this the wonders of technology? Here, you folks out there, you guys are listening to someone else wait for a web page to download.
Wow, technology.
Excitement never ends here at Rant Radio.
The bad thing is I'm not going into work tomorrow morning. I'm going somewhere else.
Where are you going?
I'm going to a client's place to work on their computer.
You know what?
If people at work are going to panic.
I don't think you are, actually.
No, I am.
I have a feeling you're not.
No.
I have a feeling they're going to call you and say, you know what? You're not going to the clients today.
No,
you're coming in here.
They know how to deal with it at work. This kind of thing. I mean, it's like
the server.
The router is not working. Or something like that. Something very simple. Well, it's contacted, obviously.
Anyways, whatever.
They just have to reboot. At minimum.
Can they hear us?
Do you have a mic?
No.
Okay. We can borrow one. There's plenty of mics to go around.
Are you aware of the Windows NT server bug?
Which one is it?
Too many small files and she crashes?
Too many small files.
Yep.
Never heard
that
one.
Do you have 98 on here?
No, at work. Oh. At work.
No, that's what happened at work. Hard drive blows. Bye!
Can't deal with it.
It screws the allocation tables.
Hmm. Interesting.
Oh, well, who cares?
Well, I installed a new backup program at work recently.
Dun, dun, dun!
And it backs up many, many files. Maybe, maybe thousands of them. So that could have been it. And it's the one that's sitting, that the web server's sitting on. So we can do a little test here and see if any of the other servers are up.
That possum just really stuck in your mind.
The possum.
That possum again.
Hey, and Faloop and Lieutenant Major Zombie, how you doing tonight?
You know, it's these loyal listeners that just, the hordes of our loyal fans that just keep us doing this.
It's because we know we can always go back and see all those, you know, the masses calling to us every week.
Shazbort and Caffeine Hire on another server.
The Edmonton Dalnet server. Well, how come we can't see them here?
Somebody has a binary.
Isn't it kind of sad, though, when the...
I'm going to check my ICQ and see if that's like flaking out.
That's
if it's getting
the DJs.
Go for it.
And we're going to go.
Somebody's
got the webcam.
That sounds
amazing.
Right.
Hey!
Oh,
no. Oh, no, they're listening.
Yes, it is the girl on the left.
Incidentally, I am still on the left, even though you can't see me.
No, she's not. She's lying to you now. Play
Yankee. She's really very conservative.
She's always telling people lies and fibbing and everything.
Excuse me.
I never get the truth out of that girl.
She's not letting her go to
that's genetic.
What's that?
Never mind. It's going to make an American political joke about being a Republican, but I decided, what's the point?
Are you accusing me of being a Republican?
No, I wouldn't
ICQ
do that.
ICQ is going
like
at glacial speed. Glacial speed, ICQ is going.
So it's
going
to get there, but...
Eventually, you know, halfway through the show, some people will start receiving their ICQs about the show being on an hour beforehand.
That's...
It's great.
Well, apparently Shazbot and Caffeine High are on...
Watch out.
The Edmonton...
Okay.
BLA or BLA.
Dalnet.
So, hi!
Oh,
NetSquid.
Oh, okay, I see why they're not here. So, yeah.
To all our listeners, whoever, wherever you are,
out
hello.
There
our other two
Magic
listeners on the split, hi!
So let's get to the news of the week.
Shit, we haven't said hello?
Oh. You are right. We haven't said hello.
I did.
So,
I said hello.
I'm gonna get on the camera.
Alright.
I'm Cimmerian. And I'm gonna go on the camera.
Hi.
I'm here.
He is Cimmerian, he is mighty.
Hi, Stevie.
Drex.
My nose is itchy.
Is it itchy?
It's not itchy, it feels like there's big piles of snot in it. That's really annoying.
Dig away.
Get back, Jojo!
And Enki is sitting at the computer, fiddling around, hopefully not destroying things. Give us a smile.
I did
That's
something
great.
Today.
That's and great. Okay.
I'm not sure if it was interesting. I can't remember. But I was going to say what happened on the show. But
Rant Radio, brought to you by drugs.
So it's kind of funny.
If you're listening, you need more.
So essentially what is, I can't remember the thing that might not have been very interesting to say anyway. And I can't remember what it is to say.
Is this disgusting to do with the eating nothing but like ice cream
using
breakfast cereal all day?
DJ Syco,
you've been using solvents
facial
for ventilation.
That's right. New and improved.
Well, I bought a new computer yesterday. And then
did you
I
sleep and between the time that you got the computer and now?
Yes.
Not much. But
what happened was I bought the computer, I just got it set up. I bought like a big 19-inch monitor.
You started playing Tomb Raider and you didn't quit.
I don't play that game.
Woohoo! A new task.
Sure you don't.
That game sucks.
Give us a wave,
anyway,
Dak.
Hi, this is Dak saying hello.
So, then they made me play role-playing instead of playing with my computer. Can you believe that? I just got it set up, ready to go, and I can like...
Those bastards. Who was
spend
it?
Some quality time with my computer.
Who was it?
James and Derek and Sean and Corey and Adrian.
Evil.
And they were
all evil.
Inspiring against me to make me play role-playing. Anyways, so when I got home at 3:30 in the morning, what do? Because you're dead. You're playing a computer.
It's like your old
Actually,
computer,
I
except
didn't
faster.
I get to play on it. I had to finish setting it up.
Sweet Jesus, my words are right. I am a nerd.
Now we've got 200% sexy projectile vomit, man.
I'm at 6:30 setting up my computer. Wow, that was pleasant.
That was nice.
And we've got the girl on the left.
Hello.
Yay. And
you know,
they
can't actually hear you talking.
We don't.
I know.
We're
not very
entertaining.
Usually somebody else
no,
could take
actually,
over introducing the people, but they can't, obviously.
Just
they're too lame.
You can't actually see any images from.
We don't.
He just aimed at me, the girl
anything.
On the left.
We don't.
No,
it's much safer that way.
Okay, now that is sounds like a conservative government. I mean, that's just...
How are we doing?
Not claiming anything?
No.
Hey, you know
okay,
Loomis Courier?
Yes.
They don't use the word guarantee. And when you call them, they don't just not use it. They say, no, sorry, we don't use that word.
Can you
we don't use the word guarantee.
You it'll be there tomorrow.
No. But it's realistic, really. If you think about it, no one can guarantee the fucking package is going to be there. FedEx can
what
say it's guaranteed all they want, but it's not really guaranteed because a guarantee, you can't guarantee anything.
That's right.
All you can do is, if it doesn't make it there, then do something to make up
yep,
for
the
it.
The plane crashed, but it will
but
be there.
It's not a guarantee.
For the company.
That's right. It's not a real guarantee.
Or your money back, or you don't have to pay for
and,
it, or something else.
And if
else.
You go to... Hey.
What?
From a
it
business.
Says minimum 8 ohms.
Probably
never
from a business
before.
Perspective,
never saw that before either.
Guarantees are a guaranteed way to lose money. Because
yes.
It's guaranteed people will take
like,
advantage of them.
Like the McDonald's thing that we were discussing
so we're
before.
At 16.
Oh, yes.
We're at 16.
Okay.
Because we have two split.
So
it
we
works.
Could split it
Actually,
two more
times.
Perhaps, perhaps our American listeners can answer a question.
Way to divide, man.
The local McDonald's.
You want to fucking go?
Huh?
Hey.
Okay, McDonald's.
The local
McDonald's
had started this wonderfully inane policy of as you go through the drive-thru, if they do not have your meal ready in 30 seconds or less, they give you a free sandwich of your choice, be it a Big Mac, whatever. Is that policy out there, or is it just the local pinheads here in British Columbia which have come up with this brilliant plan to financially guarantee the success of the company?
It's probably local. I know the McDonald's
I think it's,
don't do everything in the States and Canada at the same time.
I think it's really, really funny. I mean, I had a really simple order. All I needed was a Big Mac and two pies. And those are all ready, you know?
It's good for the consumer.
I showed up.
Maybe they figure they're making up for, like, the, you know, incredibly high local minimum wage, you know, because the local NDP government is trying to stifle small business by, you know, paying those poor wretched 16-year-olds to have slicing lettuce in the back, you know, a buck more per hour than they do in Alberta.
But you know what? They don't even try, eh? Oh. I pulled up and they're like, and they're looking at they're looking at the 30-second thing flashing. It starts flashing after 30 seconds.
So they have a light?
So if they don't
they have a little timer, yeah, so you can see the timer.
So Lieutenant Major Zombie, if
I
they don't
tell you, you got me all riled
up.
Within
2 minutes, you get a free sandwich?
Shut up, you.
That's what I'm for. Do not have that. It takes like 2 minutes to have get it.
this is what we
have get it.
But at Taco Bell, you can get a taco in 10 seconds. We're not asking how long it takes. We're asking if they have a policy that if they do not get your order to you in the drive-thru.
You want a what? Taco? Pull!
Hey.
Thank you for calling Rare Radio. Wait, I pressed the button, damn it! Thank you for calling Rare Radio. Who is this? Oh, guess who it is?
Lieutenant Major Zombie.
Good guess!
Get the phone over here.
Hey, Lieutenant Major Zombie, how's it going?
It's the chicken, I lied!
You tried, really hard.
I did try.
So what's up, man?
I'm just calling a favor, I'm getting here, on Devastore, so I'm gonna bed right now and...
Actually, sorry, chicken, it's not time to call in yet.
No, he's saying something about...
It's not our call-in time of the show, so...
Somebody curb him.
Somebody curb stomp him.
Wait. Okay, what were you saying about the movie man and going to bed and all that?
Yeah, then the movie man is going to bed and doesn't want to call any phone calls tonight because he's got to be up at the crack of dawn to do management stuff.
Okay.
He's got to be up at the crack of dawn, I'm not feeling well going to work at my job too, so...
Okay.
Look at those babies.
Don't call it.
Okay, we won't then. Doug, get away! Jeez.
Okay.
Drex is like
just
crazy on the phone.
He just you know what? But I think I have a valid reason for it. It's not time to call in yet.
That's important information about not phoning and disturbing them.
That's right.
So sounds selfish to me.
Do you have a joke to tell us?
I have a joke to tell you. Something. Yeah, okay, I've got a joke I can tell
you. Because you got to make up for the movie, man.
Okay, no problem.
Okay.
Well, a girl talks to her mom one day and she says, Mommy, you know, how have babies and stuff like that? She says, well, it's pretty simple. The man or the husband comes along and her daddy puts his penis in Mommy's vagina and he's got a, and then a couple months later there's a baby. And she's like, that's why you're taking daddy's penis in your mouth that night. Oh, yes, honey, that's why I get jewelry.
I'll see you tomorrow at Fat Slice.
Wait, come on, guys. We can give him some more support than that. I know what it's like to tell a joke and have no support. You know?
Okay,
so let's try a little. No, wait.
That's
right. Listen. Let's give him some
true.
Support.
That sounds like you're laughing at him.
That's not entirely true. We have laughed every time you told a joke.
That's because he's in the room and he carries knives.
No, you didn't laugh. You guys sat there looking at me like,
what was that? We laugh every time you tell a joke.
Okay, we're going to watch it.
That's
not true.
That's just because usually after he tells a joke,
say what the hell.
Something funny.
Say what the hell.
You didn't laugh with me or at me at all, actually.
You didn't tell the joke last time.
Into the microphone, Jack.
You didn't tell the joke?
I'm not arguing with you about it, okay? I'm not arguing with you about a nothing
topic. Well,
bring up a something topic
maybe
and I'll argue with
like
you, but I'm not
going to
argue with you on a nothing topic.
Maybe I have to
like
argue about nothing.
Chicken sounded so much like a weird-ass American... The chicken sounded so much like a weird-ass American drawl, I didn't question it for a second. It was Lieutenant Major Zombie.
Really?
This is Lieutenant Major Zombie.
That's what he would sound like.
Lieutenant Major Zombie doesn't sound like that. Lieutenant Major Zombie sounds like somebody doing a really good... Honestly, sounds like somebody doing like a really good Beavis and Butthead impression.
Girl, girl, you're cold.
The timbre of the voice, like the quality of the voice, somehow reminds me of that. But then again, I'm a Canadian. not the laugh.
I don't better spell it.
I've ever heard the Lieutenant Major Zombie laugh like Beavis and Butthead.
Thank you.
What treat do we have later on?
We have
Hawflakes. You know what Hoff flakes
spell
are made
out.
From?
Spell that out.
H-A-W. You know what Hoff flakes are made from? They're made from Hoff and sugar.
And sugar. You can't get more simple than that.
I got this. I found out about this wonderful product from some of my friends at the student paper up at Santa Fraser University.
Uh-huh.
And,
Is it a candy, or do you put things on it, or?
It's sort of
given
a candy.
Out at church.
They look like little
if they were
universe.
White, I would recognize those.
Did you get my ICQ message?
Communion Hoff flakes.
Yeah, they
Communion Hoff flakes.
Yes, I did. It was
like see a Hoff first.
They've got quite the interesting cover artwork on, because they got these, you know, wonderfully painted sort of cherry-like branch, you know, very sort of impressionistic, and then at the bottom of it they've got this whack-ass looking little cartoon character who looks like he's humping a cherry.
That's disgusting.
Humping a cherry.
Oh yeah.
Actually, it looks like the cherry is humping him.
Yeah, it looks in the submissive role.
Cherry is definitely dominant in that relationship.
Yeah, so it must be sentient. So we're going to do the news of the week.
Cherry with whips.
There are three listeners or four listeners that we have.
Blue dressed up in
tell cool. me when the screen cap works.
Quaint evening we have. And for you.
Yeah, for those of you who've seen Payback.
Okay. New.
Incidentally, Enki, the webcam isn't working.
Yeah, that's
if
right.
They're smart enough.
If they're smart enough,
they'll be able to see it.
Yes.
But that's highly unlikely. But
so
it's good for video capture later.
Well, that's highly unlikely.
Here's the news promo.
I know how stupid you all are.
Let's have a contest with you. Guess the number. Tell everybody you can see the picture.
It's time for the news and web pages of the week. You have an interesting news item or web page, send it to me, Cimmerian, at ICQ number 51.
Where did you find this?
It's the peanuts.
I know, but where did you find the peanuts?
I type in peanuts theme and magically it appears. Yeah. I am amazing.
You are.
Finding things on the internet.
The master of the search.
I will be able to find anything.
I remember, I am not on the internet. The only time I even...
You don't have to go on the internet to get it. It's on the Peanuts Christmas album, the soundtrack for the original special.
Oh,
yeah,
if I
want
to
right,
that.
That's right. And we all have that. So
well, actually, no, he's not. I know what he's talking about. I actually have a couple of people who
can,
do have that.
You can go to any record store and get it very easily.
It was very, it was in the stores.
And it probably costs about as much as, oh no, wait a minute, it costs a lot less on the internet.
Like free.
Like free.
Okay,
don't eat it yet. We're going to do this as a feature.
I'm just eating one. You guys can eat yours
later.
She's
junk
food.
She has to get reactions. You've already had these then.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay, well, then
if she lives, we can all have one.
Okay, nobody else eat them until... We'll do this after the news.
I just like to
one.
Go on the record now for saying I'm not eating any candy that advertises itself.
And sugar.
With cherries humping children. I will not eat cherries humping children candy.
Say no to fruit sex.
There's a lot of very disappointed bananas out there.
So here's two sad and...
Coincidentally, you could probably find pictures on the internet about that too.
Well, you can... Here's two sad and lonely...
Hey!
Sex. Not just for animals anymore.
No matter how weird and degenerate, if you can imagine it, it's out there.
Cool.
Oh, did you show everybody that power puking picture I sent you before I went on vacation?
No, I didn't.
That's a lovely
it was
picture.
Very good, yes. Maybe I will remember to do that for one time. Here's two sad and lonely individuals who decided to put up a web page. It's called The Contest. Days with no sex, 199 and counting. It says, here's the story, Brandon and Rick never get laid. So on April 29th, 1999, while eating egg rolls, sweet and sour chicken at the mall, they decided to count the days until the next time one of them scores. The contest actually started a really, really long time ago because neither party is willing or able to produce accurate dates of any previous sexual encounters. April 29th will be ground zero. Rick and Brandon, the contestants, will keep a complete log of any progress they make in achieving their goal. The log can be seen here, assuming any progress is ever made. The winner of the contest gets a Jägermeister keychain. Here are the rules.
Jägermeister.
Sexual intercourse must occur between one of the contestants and a consenting female, henceforth referred to as subject, between the ages of 18 and 46. The subject must be human. Contestants can it be in no way related to the subject.
Oh.
Related does include cousins, second cousins, and half-sisters. The use of alcohol and or drugs is discouraged, but not against the rules. The contestants may not at any time mention the contest to the subject. Contestants may not offer money and or gifts in exchange for sex. Twinkies and other snap cakes are considered gifts.
Oh!
Wait a second, I think I know her.
The subject must not be conducting any type of sexual, sociological, physiological, biological or geological
study.
Geological?
A bunch of technical studies.
Yeah, on the contestants. We're not guinea pigs. Oral sex does not count, but it would be greatly appreciated. Subjects must be meeting the following physical qualifications. Must be within 60 pounds of the contestant's weight. Can have no more than 3 tattoos. Can have no more than 1 reproductive organ. No hermaphrodites. Cannot be connected to any life-preserving devices. I think that goes in conjunction with the consenting part.
Is there anything about the contestant being alive then?
Yes.
Consenting.
Consenting. You have to be consenting. I don't think you can get consent from a dead person. Unless they wrote it in a will.
Doesn't want to have sex? Raise your hand. Sounds good.
What's that bad joke we heard long time ago when it came to parties?
Oh, which one? You have to remind me.
Necrophilia means never having to say you're sorry.
Oh, yeah!
Deep sympathy, which is not released on any of the Spike and Mikes.
I wonder why.
Yeah. Subjects must meet the following intellectual qualifications. Must be a high school graduate or possess a GED. Must be able to speak at least one language semi-fluently. Cannot spell was or any other word ending with an S with a Z, i.e. was. I guess Lieutenant Major Zombie's out of the running if he was.
No IRC folks.
I can list at least three girls which would be disqualified.
Oh, okay. All right, this last one is going to be interesting. Proof of intercourse must be provided.
A handwritten
admission from the subject is the preferred form of proof, but just about anything will work. The honor system is to be observed.
I don't know if a full condom would work. I mean, you still can't prove it.
Yeah.
Well, no, it depends what it smells like.
True. They've had 199 days to perfect the smell, I guess. Okay.
People, why do you know him?
Okay, let's check
accident
out
of birth.
Your parents are not an excuse.
Let's check out the log file of their progress. April 29th, 1999. The contest officially begins. April 30th, no progress to report. And it continues on till May 6th. Rick successfully acquires a girl's telephone number. Nothing happens till May 21st. Rick and Brandon go to the pub and look at butts. May 28th, Rick leaves rambling, incoherent message on girl's answering machine. June 2nd, Brandon passes up opportunity to win the contest with a weird girl.
Rick buys a comic book.
Rick buys a comic book. Somehow he sees this as progress in the contest.
I've seen some comic books. I think I know what he's talking about.
Instructional comic books. Okay. June 18th, Rick and Brandon almost witness two girls making out at Heroes. I guess that's a restaurant. Whoa, long stretch here. August 6th, Rick talks to a girl on phone. Sex is not discussed. Yes, it is the same girl from May 28th, 1999.
It's a long, dry summer for
these boys. Rick turns 23.
Oh. September 2nd, Brandon offers a girl the use of his dictionary. She says, no thank you. Wow, they're getting down to the nitty-gritty here. September 4th, Brandon forms a deep emotional bond with a beer coaster.
Oh, boy.
Scroll. October 23rd, Rick and Brandon go to a bar and actually talk to women.
Wow.
And that takes us to the present date. Well, almost, until they update it, I guess.
Are they really trying to win this contest?
I think the real contest is to lose this contest.
Yeah, no kidding.
Yeah. Here's some weird mail they've got. Some of the people who visit the contest aren't content making bets. There's like a bet page, virtual bets. And are keeping records of those who bet on the loser won't be expecting to pay up. Here they are. I think you'll win, but you'll need drugs. Good luck, Brandon. I don't know you, but I hope you win. Having your own set of dishes is a turn on. They have a little... They actually have a rundown. Maybe I should go to that
No,
first.
No, that's fine.
That's fine. It tells a little about them. Name, Rick. Age, 23. Height, 5'10". Weight, 130 pounds. On the cusp... Sign, on the cusp between Leo and Virgo. Favorite color, glow-in-the-dark. Turn-ons, nice hair, a sense of humor, and a big-ass motherfucking... And big-ass motherfucking tits. Turn-off, I used to have some, but I just don't care anymore. Most impressive...
Yeah.
Most impressive achievement, staying not dead this long. And the other guy, Brandon, 23, 5'8", 140. It's a little bit shorter, a little bit fatter. Sign, Aquarius, favorite color, grape sour appleberry. Turn-ons, nice hair, sense of humor, and big-ass motherfucking tits. Turn-offs, Jersey accents. Most impressive achievement. I have my very own dishes.
Bet on Brandon. He has much better taste.
Okay.
He has taste of any kind. He's the only one that's making any distinctions anymore.
Right.
Here's a sad couple of people. Another sad couple of people. These people were married.
Thank you.
Were married, but they're not married anymore. And it's... titled, Coupled Ordered to Split Beanie Baby Collection.
Oh, what? Oh, God. Have we reached this low point?
No, this is great. This is great. Think of society so utopian where the only thing people can find to argue about is who gets to keep the beanie babies.
That's a different aspect of it.
I'm trying to think, like, if they have, like, a Solomonic decision here, where it's like they're fighting over that...
we're gonna chop it!
Yeah, they're fighting over that last...
Beanie Baby.
Yeah, like, I don't know, it's, you know, a, you know, like, what they've got the stupidest name
for Hobby the Frog.
That's like, yeah, what's going on.
Like,
yeah.
Batty the Bat, you know, it's...
Maple the Bear was the first to go.
A divorced couple couldn't agree on how to split their Beanie Baby collection, so a judge ordered them on Friday to divide up the babies one by one in a courtroom. It's ridiculous and embarrassing, says Frances Mountain, moments before squatting on the courtroom floor, aside her ex-husbands to choose first from a pile of dozens of stuffed toys. Maple the Bear was the first to go, as a few people in the gallery snickered. Wow, this could be only onion.
Okay.
It is so weird. Francis and Harold Mountain divorced 4 months ago, and according to the divorce decree, were supposed to split their Beanie Baby collection, estimated worth between $2,500 and $5,000. But they failed to do so after Mountain filed a motion to get his share of the litter. The judge had said he had had enough. Because you folks can't solve this, it takes the services of a judge, a bailiff, and a court reporter.
May I make a suggestion?
Uh-huh.
I think they should take the two of them, place them in an arena, and make them fight to death over the collection.
What about...
Because
no.
Thank God they don't have kids.
What
That's
about the
life.
Beanie Baby they get to pick last? What about that Beanie Baby's feelings?
That's kind right.
Of
what the hell?
You know, you see, the reason I'd like...
Have you ever been picked last in a gym class?
No.
Yes.
Yes?
Yes.
Everybody.
Fuck!
Actually, I haven't.
Oh, hey,
I didn't
Kathy,
get class by
son.
Friends, but not by the gym class.
Somebody else has made their way to the IFC.
Yes!
Wow. That's pretty good.
Who's caffeine high?
He's been here before.
Yeah,
you must have figured out the next.
Did you guys hear? Did you hear this one? Texas schoolboy was arrested for a scary story.
Yep.
Oh yeah,
got it right here.
Yes.
That one drove me to the point of considering the state of Texas to be removed from the plane of Earth. Please, yeah. It's...
So here's that story. Texas schoolboy freed after scary Halloween essay lands him in jail. A 13-year-old boy has been freed after spending 5 days in custody because the Halloween horror story he wrote as a school assignment describes shooting a teacher and two classmates. I was supposed to write a horror story. I don't think I did anything wrong. His English teacher, Amanda Henry, thought he did such a good job she gave him an A, plus extra credit for reading aloud in class. Yet later she went to the principal and turned him in for it.
This woman needs
yeah.
a lot of fucking help. and the principal needs a lot of help, and the whole zero tolerance.
Okay, wait. Well, okay, don't you have to commit a crime to go to jail?
No, not anymore. Basically, this
it's
is
thought crime.
It
now.
Was basically filed under the concept of being uttering threats towards people by using actual people from his school, because the kid wasn't imaginative enough to come up with new names and new people by placing himself and his classmates in the horror story. He uttered threats by being responsible. And by the way, I've heard about the story. He wasn't trying to shoot his teacher and two classmates. It was done as an accident by supposedly over-responding to the fear of the situation in the short story. Mm-hmm. They accidentally shot his teacher and two other people, and the irony of the situation was realizing they had over-responded and accidentally shot his teacher and two of his classmates. That was the story. For a 13-year-old kid, not a bad piece of work.
Yeah.
For his teachers and the cops to bust the kid and put him in juvenile detention for 5 fucking days.
5 days.
For this.
And presumably it would have been longer if the folks at CNN and such had glommed onto the story.
No, really.
He was asked to write a scary story. He did! He scared the shit out of people across the bloody country!
It's the irony.
This actually is probably a good thing that happened. I mean, it's bad for this kid, but down in the States, I've read a lot about stuff like this happening.
So you get
for
drinking.
I think that it's important that the parents of this kid sue the school board, the school, the police, everybody, blind. They need to lose a lot of money so that they'll think twice about doing this to another kid.
No, are you rest of this?
Justified suing.
Given the fact of how litigation insane the United States is, ambulance chasers have been running down these parents to try to basically offer their services to take these people to hell and high water. No, instead, what the parents are planning on doing is they're removing their kids and start taking them to either private school or home teaching in order to just basically forget about the whole situation. I'm sorry, I think somebody needs to lose their job over this one, boys and girls.
But the thing is, what's going to happen to the 13-year-old kid in the meantime?
Yes, no, he's got to basically...
He's got to get an education somewhere.
Yeah, and the kid's basically, not to mention what a wonderful additive this does to his whole social growth.
I think everyone involved should lose their job. The judge, all the people involved in the court case or whatever it is. Everyone who touched it, who knew about it, had the power to stop it and didn't, should be going to jail themselves.
You ready for this? There is no judge involved in this case. There is no judge involved in this.
You can send someone to jail without even a judge.
Because he had already violated an existing zero-tolerance order. He was placed in juvenile by social...
Oh, I've heard about like these zero tolerance laws now in the States. It's like when kids can go to jail for dealing drugs if they give their friend an aspirin.
But don't they at least have to prove that he did it in court?
No, the kid didn't even have to go through that. Boys and girls, our American listeners, remember 200 and some odd years ago, you fought a revolution against tyranny. Please, many of you have guns. Start again. We'll follow you here up in the north. Please, start it.
But you can have it zero tolerance all you want, but don't you have to prove that the act they committed against the zero tolerance?
No, because he wasn't arrested and placed in jail by an officer of the court. He was placed in by a social worker.
Welcome to the era of thought crime, where an accusation stands as proof.
He's right. It is
so
insane.
So how about the thought that maybe this kid might get enraged now and have to kill the social worker, because he's crazy, but because he's totally sane and knows that this is the right thing to do.
Because, well, then you see, he would be right. And, I'd like to actually think that maybe God would like help us out with, like, a meteorite someday.
On to the next story. This is Justice. Spammers killed execution style.
Woo-hoo! Yeah! That's you, James.
There is a guy.
Bloody hell.
Yeah, they were involved in other dealings, but they were big-time spammers, and they got killed.
How did they get killed?
Execution
point blank. Bullet to the head.
Goes to show what goes around.
Comes around. That's right.
Yeah, one in a billion, is it? One in, like, say, 100,000? It comes around? Yeah, that's it.
One will work for me.
Let's keep our perspective.
ISP Tech Hell?
ISP Tech Hell. Let's see what this is. A little bit old, so I forgot about it. We'll post this. Sorry for that last link. That did not work.
Yeah, this
is perfect.
The following grief was sent in by
Andrew.
I was on the phone with a very blonde blonde customer. She was a computer newbie and dumb as a stick when it came to mundane things. Never mind something as high-tech as a computer. She called to report that her computer stopped moving. Okay, what do you see? I asked. Just the clouds, she replied. Okay, could you shut off the computer and turn it back on again? Sure, she said. I hear a click, then another click. As she turns it back on, I waited, not saying anything, for several moments. Finally, I said, what do you see now? The same thing, she says. What? It froze immediately after boot up? That was not good. Okay, turn it off and turn it back on again. I hear two clicks. I immediately ask her what she sees. The same thing, she says. She says, then she asks me, should I turn off the hard drive too? She's turning off her monitor.
I have a story from another Andrew. Andrew, our buddy,
yeah.
He works for the realtor board, dealing with people who are using their computers.
Oh, realtors.
He gets this call.
High on the level.
No lie on this one. The person calls up, said their computer is not working. They have no idea. They just bought it.
Listen to the mic.
It stopped working after about a half an hour.
Yeah.
So he asks them, you know, turn it off, turn it on. Have you got all the plugs in? They check it. Yes. They're going through all the problems that possibly be. I mean, just not getting anything, not even an image. Well, it turns out that he was undergoing a blackout.
Oh!
And he didn't know why his computer wasn't working. I'm not making this up.
That's, you know what? That's just as bad as what I thought. What I thought was that, oh, his power management had kicked in and the computer turned off and you couldn't figure out why.
Screensaver.
Go to the bottom. I think there's one with the PlayStation.
Oh, apparently, Sega Dreamcast have a telnet port open. We should have that too.
There's
a while ago.
Oh, yeah, that's
all of it.
There it is. That's the one.
This is the one. It says, the title is Throwing Down the Gauntlet, My Best Experience as a Nerd in Hell. I used to work for a major ISP as a telephone tech support rep. For those of you who have done this in the past, you know that this leads to almost endless grief and great stories. Wait, here's one now. This didn't happen to me, but I was sitting in the cube next to a guy who got this call. By the end, everybody in the room was standing around listening. A very angry guy called one time. He was choked that the CD-ROM, which contained our ISP software, Netscape and Win95 dial-up network connection, would not install in his system. He was clearly a very inexperienced user. After nearly 15 minutes of questions, the tech finally discovered the problem. The guy was trying to load the CD in his Sony PlayStation. Not only that, he figured that the minimum requirements on the box, Win95, 8 megabytes of RAM and a CD-ROM, did not specifically indicate that a PlayStation did not meet these requirements. He went on for 30 minutes about how this was a breach of the contract he signed when he purchased the service package with the ISP. Finally, it got to the point where the tech had to dish the guy off to sales desk for a refund. I heard later that the guy raised such hell with the sales department that they refunded his money and agreed to add a warning to the software box indicating that an actual PC was one of the minimum requirements. Still want to know why I quit that job?
No.
Easy
no.
Solution. Get your PlayStation box. Does it say it includes Win95 or 8 megabytes of RAM? No? Well, you can't run our software. Very simple.
Yeah.
Does it say on the package?
I have an even easier solution. Sorry. I do it all the time. Click. And he calls back. Click.
Would you
don't want to talk to you. Click. It's not time to call in. It's not the time of our show to call in. Click. Say what the hell and I'll hang up on you. Click.
The thing against
it works very well.
Is that the Dreamcast is based on Windows CE, so
yeah,
there's going to be
danger.
Some more interesting calls about that, especially since it has a built-in modem.
That's right. It has
so
a modem,
like these
it has
new,
RAM,
these
it
next
has Windows.
This sort of next generation of gaming machines, those kinds of calls will just get more insane.
That's right.
It has Windows on it. I think a PlayStation should come with like a barrel and a round, and it can be remotely discharged.
Just the reset button.
Use a reset button.
In a specific, like,
specific text, something like embedded into the framework of the machine that you have to be at a certain, your head has to be in a certain position in order to read it, so that it'll be perfectly lined up.
Look right at the center of the CD.
Yes.
And then when they try and bring it back, no, the reason it's not working is you got blood. Politics.
They said PS2 runs on Linux. PS2 has cable modem.
Huh?
Not that I know.
No, actually, the PlayStation 2 is like the Dreamcast, apparently. It can boot up its own operating system. And the PS2, I heard rumors that they're going to have a cable modem attachment available, like an Ethernet port. But we'll see.
Basically, the game console market is trying to beat the PC game market by making them more like PCs. Can't beat them, join them.
That's right.
Meanwhile, all the PC makers, all these little PC companies are trying to make emulators.
That's right.
Okay, but you know what? The emulators, that's like really stupid. Okay, the thing that makes computers weak is that they have to run on like an operating system and they don't have something nice like cards.
Yeah, that just always
that
work.
That just work. And
we know your hardware.
They're taking their machine that its strength is that it doesn't have an operating system. That is its only strength. And taking that away, but still doesn't have all the strength of the computer, which is everything else.
Yeah.
That's stupid. That's just stupid. The only thing they have is it is probably cheaper.
Actually, the strength of the console isn't the fact that it doesn't have an operating system, because all of them do. Even the shitty old ones still have some built-in calls.
But
the strength is unified hardware. They're all the exact same stuff inside, so you don't have driver conflicts.
Yeah,
and all
they
that
might
stuff.
Have.
It always
they,
works.
Okay, they
always
have
works.
An operating system,
yes.
But it's not like soft like on here. It's not on a disk.
Mm-hmm.
It's not booted up every time. It's
that's
it's,
true.
It's
on
a card,
chip, yeah.
Right?
It's firmware.
That's what we're saying, right? It's all on a card.
It doesn't
works
change.
Every time. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
The only thing I don't like about console games is if you get a game, it's buggy as hell, it crashes, it's fucked.
Yeah.
You can't update it.
That's right. Like that's it. That's all you get.
I know.
Unless it's really massive.
I think I've
heard
of a recall.
Unless there's like a massive,
yeah,
a recall.
It's really bad.
Whether
it freezes
it always works
on the start
or always
screen.
Doesn't. I've had this conversation before. Nothing infuriates me more than the concept of them being allowed to sell a product that doesn't work.
That's,
that requires you to go to their webpage to get an update. So you can make the system
that's,
work. Yeah, sorry. You know, I'd like to find the first company that did that and the first 10 million people who accept it. And by the way, if that would include everyone in this room, I'd say I'd kiss
you.
Desmond,
you know
what shoot them in the face.
You know what the problem is? Desmond, you know what the problem is?
What?
If they didn't do that, we'd be way back there in time.
That's right.
Now.
Yeah.
The
this,
programs
this
we
is,
had
this,
now
this is
would be way
case.
Back.
This is my character.
That's why we have...
We got
VCR still instead of digital video recorders because they wait 10 years till they're not buggy anymore.
We basically
I'm willing
they
to wait 10 years for something that actually works.
We still be in.
Yeah,
still
but you know what?
Dogs.
My computer, as much as it fucks up, it doesn't fuck up that much that I'm not willing. And yeah, you're right. I am willing to accept it to have a computer that's way faster than what I would have if it had to be perfect before they sold it.
No, I don't think things have to be perfect, but I think that
functionally would be nice.
Yeah,
you know what? They are functional.
It's a catch 22. The consumers don't care.
That's what
they
I'm saying.
And
I understand.
And then
that.
The companies
no,
go.
I know that. That's why
right?
I'm saying
no.
I'd like to take the company who first did this and
right.
the first group of people of customers who accepted it and kill them.
Yeah.
You're also
just
talking about problems that don't come up until they send it out because then they have that many people testing it.
Yes.
And they don't. It has to be tested
that's
that
how
much
it works
before
nowadays.
They come, before they find those problems because they just don't happen.
They don't
well.
Test it in house nowadays. They let the people
they
test it.
At least they don't charge it for them.
Right.
Yeah, well, that's kind of nice, right?
There's been, I think, a couple companies that tried that. It's like, no.
Try to charge you for updates for a broken piece of
there's
software.
Some
really?
Software.
Yes.
Wow, that's bad. That's when you get shot in
the head. Lynch mob material.
That's at the point where you're handing you the gun?
Oh, yeah, they got
it. I would hand you the gun right away. I would just counsel you not to use it.
Well, actually... A lot of non-game related software companies, I think, still do charge you for updates. Like,
some big company software like.
I think SCO Unix.
Okay, but it depends on what the update is. If it's an update, like an upgrade,
like
Y2K. But if it's just making something work.
Yeah,
they
charge you for Y2K. Almost all
society.
Almost all software does.
I don't want Y2K to collapse.
It's their lack of foresight. You have to pay for it. It's complete crap.
Wait a minute. Yeah, it's their lack of foresight, but. I totally disagree. That's wrong. They made a mistake, but that's not the same thing as not making the program work.
Well, it's kind of the same thing, basically.
Well, okay, look at all the computers that are still used in the banks. Well, fuck you! You should have thought of that 40 years ago when you made the program we're still using in our banks and shit.
Well, that's almost the same thing as basically if Boeing happened to make an airplane that when you basically went into a dive that the engines decided to go into reverse. You know, it's it works most of the time. Just don't do this until you get an upgrade.
There's a line in time where I would say, okay, yeah, after a certain point, after it became obvious that, yeah, this needed to be done, they still started making programs and equipment that wasn't Y2K. And then, yeah, I think that they're wrong and that they should have to make it Y2K compliant, right? Because, I mean, we've known for years, and they still pumped out, like, motherboards and computers that weren't Y2K. And that's wrong.
They hedged their bets that they wouldn't be around. Whoever was president of the company or whoever was in charge of...
And they're right in most cases. Would have opened by that time,
and they
would have gotten their honky asses off to the next thing.
That's right.
Find them and kill them.
They're right.
Find them and kill them.
I mean, most people won't even have those computers. Mm-hmm. Well, probably because they're going to buy new computers so they can write it off.
So, I did another Sean Kay little rant here. This one is called Hooked on Crack. And I think it was inspired by Drex. Because you were ranting about it before.
Yeah.
How can people get hooked on crack? It's pretty good.
How do you miss the fact that crack?
Hi, you're on Rat Radio. Who is this? Okay, what do you have to say? Yes. Okay, get away.
You got 20 minutes to wait.
Oh no, that's it. I don't know what you're getting a little crazy.
He was
doing Beavis and Butthead.
Oh, okay. Somewhat relevant, but he can do that later. That's not very.
You got him.
You gotta wait until 10:30. That's when we start accepting calls. If we accept them
all, hot and bothered.
Can he see you in the webcam?
I don't know. If he can. Is the webcam working?
So how does it feel to be stuck?
Oh, yeah, he can't even see. The webcam is working.
The pain in that voice made this all worthwhile.
300 billion pictures of hot and sexy chicks on the net.
Hey!
And this guy has to single me out.
Be grateful.
In the
Spectre was going after him for a while.
When do we see the calendar?
So, because he doesn't get any of the action in the scenario.
Yeah,
to you next.
Shut up.
Wouldn't it be quicker if it found out what it was and saved it on your computer?
Somebody can go much possible, okay? I mean, just leave me out of
this. So this one's called Hooked on Crack, and we're going to listen to it.
All
right. Awesome, right?
What the fuck? Those you asked for is your pal and mine, Sean Kennedy on WHAT Radio.
That's just how it works. Okay, I'm a little fuzzy on a couple issues here. Maybe somebody can help me out on this. I'm a little curious as to how somebody exactly gets hooked on crack. Like, how does that work, you know? Like, do you know, you're smoking up at some party sometime and somebody, you know, slips a fucking glass pipe in your hands instead of a doobie? Or is it, you know, you're going to the bathroom sometime and work on the graffiti on the wall at some drug-induced fuckface snared there with his own fecal matter and you think, hey, he said crack is fun, maybe I should try that. So you become, you know, hooked on crack, okay? There is absolutely no excuse for being hooked on crack. If you don't want to be hooked on crack, don't do crack. It's not like there's less degrees of crack. There's crack and crack. Okay, you just go and become hooked on crack. Like, what the fuck? You doing crack for the first time you have to realize that it's an addictive drug and you're going to become hooked on it. It's just the way it is. I mean, how dumb do you have to be? I don't really grasp people. So when people wind up, especially when they're like middle class people, hooked on crack. I mean, if there's a bunch of street fucking people and they're all hooked on crack because, you know, their lives are shit and they just want to fucking die anyway, okay, then, you know, that's kind of a governmental problem too because, you know, no one's looking after anybody and, you know, a lot of people don't have a chance to start with. So I can understand that. But, you know, like, middle class Americans getting hooked on crack? What? There is no reason why any county should get fucking hooked on crack. Let me tell you, there is no fucking reason for it. If there's a guy who walks up to me in his mid-40s with an Astro Man and says, yeah, I've got a crack problem, it's like, right up to the brainstem, it's a fucking head comes off. That's just how it works. I have no time for you. If you're gonna go get hooked on crack, do it some fucking place else. Do it when you're a totally weak piece of shit. Do it and then kill yourself, so I don't have to deal with it. I deal with you breaking into my car or stealing my shit, getting rid of it, of crack. Okay? So give me a fucking break. My name is Sean Kennedy, and I am a fucking man.
That was good. Not bad.
If you would like to email death threats or send mail bombs to anyone you're listening to tonight, or what the hell, email us at info@ranchradio.com or send explosive charges to Box 256 or IABC Canada, B0X1J0, or Mama Mia ICQ number 51558. Cash or visuals greatly appreciated.
Now back to the What the Hell Show with M&M's and Dr. Pepper 2. M&M's are good.
There's no M&M's tonight, but there is Dr.
Pepper. We also have carbon cookies.
On that crack thing,
yeah.
There are crack houses in Langley.
I remember they were on 56 or something. Right across from...
I don't know where they are.
Weren't they like across from the A&W?
Yeah, across from the A&W. Those run down houses.
Oh, yeah, those two or three really disgusting houses.
Oh, yeah.
Well, hey, I mean, I lived across the corner from like the biggest pot bust in British Columbia history. There was like, I was, you know, getting up Saturday morning once, and there was like helicopters overhead circling, and it's just like, what the fuck did we do now? Come on!
Uh-oh. Derek?
Okay, but the idea is that if there's crack houses in Langley, that means there are people smoking
crack
in Langley.
Yeah.
We already went over this.
Oh, Langley crack's good. They come from Vancouver.
it's good crack. It's non-addictive, and it doesn't fuck up your brain.
The thing,
Langley, land of churches.
The thing I have trouble remembering, when I came here for the first time back in 1982, I came from Brooklyn, New York, okay? My neighborhood was like, I had two choices. I could go one way and go with Spanish, or I could go the other way and go with Sicilians. I lived four blocks from one of the mob bosses from Brooklyn got hit.
Uh-huh.
So this was my growing up neighborhood. I came out here, I lost my mind. I now look around and I cannot believe that this place is the largest drug processing, facilitating, growing operation.
But we're nice about it.
In on the West Coast.
Thanks to our warm, moist climate. Yeah.
There's like LA down there, and we beat them? What the fuck?
Well, exports, big industry.
Yes. Well, you know, I mean, I'd love to see if somebody could actually compile some honest, straight, like, truthful statistics. I mean, comparing pot to, say, the timber industry, or the mining industry.
Gauge it with, like, a pie chart or something?
Yeah, or, you know, like, what percentage of the sort of gross national product of coming from BC comes from pot sales? I bet that it's fairly comparative with all these industries that are coddled by government.
Nice red wedge.
It is our number one green.
It is. No, they're not making a joke. It is now the largest, by money, we're talking about by value, it is the largest cash crop. In the province.
Boggles my mind that the government doesn't get in on it.
Legalize it and
tax it and you're out of debt.
And did you hear about that group that recently? I think they were
in. And you know, if we did that, maybe we'd even be able to weasel our way out of NAFTA. The Americans would be like, you're going to do that? Fuck you, we're out of NAFTA. They're like, woohoo! Have a nice time!
You know what? They don't even have to make it legal to smoke pot in BC. They just have to make it legal to grow it and process it and sell it to other places.
Send it off.
They can grow it and process it
across the border
and
a little bit harder.
And then it can also be like an industry growing, you know, the hemp, you know, and so you can sell all the, like, you know, you know, ugly ass hemp clothing to hippie shops across the country.
You know, everyone talks about how ugly hemp clothing is, but
it's not the fact. It's not the hemp itself. It's the fact that they're marketing it towards hippies.
Yeah, I know, but the thing is, have you ever seen how long that shit lasts?
That's what I want. A really, really, really ugly jacket or coat or pants that won't go away.
So you can will it to your children.
And cause them to run around with really, really, really ugly clothing as well.
The other thing is, better for paper. Like for newspaper, for newsprint, it is a superior form of paper.
What exactly was that U.S. Constitution written on again?
Yes, for those of you who don't remember these things, we will.
First draft of it, not the actual one, but one of the drafts.
No, the one of the drafts was actually written on hemp. The one that's seen, the one that's commonly thought of, is made from vellum, which is the inside of a lamb's stomach, the actual soft tissue, which is then basically tanned into a very nice form of.
The thing about hemp is whether it's better paper or not doesn't matter. It is, but even if it's just on par, it's renewable.
Yes, it grows faster, it's cheaper.
You can make more paper from it, and you don't have to cut down trees.
That's right.
I got a chance to try.
You can get lumberjacks growing hemp.
I got a chance to try hemp.
And eat spotted owls.
Hemp? No, not eat. I got a chance to try hemp toilet paper.
Okay. How was it, Dad?
It was soft.
Was it soft? It didn't chafe your buttocks?
No, it didn't.
It didn't put a ring around your anus?
Speaking of that, it's time to eat those things.
Oh, yes!
Let's have the hamper up.
Okay, now.
I'm sorry, segue, Sil.
That's great. I can just move from one to another.
All right,
unlike Casey Kasem.
He can't do that?
He can't go with that. Okay. He can't go with the... dead dog.
Segue from an up-tempo tune to
up-tempo
a dead dog dedication.
I heard that.
I played it a bunch of times. It's just
anyways,
too funny. Okay,
what these things are is they're haw flakes made from genuine haw, H-A-W. Haw ingredients. Haw sugar. Brought from China.
Is there any explanation of what haw is?
No,
there's not. All there is this cartoon on the front, which I've already explained, which looks like a bizarre sort of Alvin and the Chipmunks looking character having conjugal relations with Cherry.
We've got a definition of haw. It's from a hawthorn berry.
Okay, I thought it was related to hawthorn.
There we go.
Hmm. And on the front it says Jing Ji Shan Zha.
I'll be
looking at it. Anyways, so we have these little circular plates that will look like communion wafers, except they're pinkish in color.
No, there's a chance my girlfriend might actually know what that is.
Okay.
What?
And now I'm going to...
Anyways.
All right, so just...
grab
one of these things.
You can do it. You put it up.
I got a feeling she'd like freeze, like...
Don't tell her she's on the radio. With 1.2 potential million listeners.
Hey, wow, it's like hockey card gum.
Yes, it is.
There you go.
Amazing.
There's yours,
James.
I'm not having one.
No hawthorn berry.
It is hockey card gum.
I'm allergic to haw.
It smells like
you're allergic to haw.
It does. It smells like potpourri.
Put it in the mouth and give us a reaction every time.
No.
It reminds me of cranberry.
No.
This
tastes like fruit leather to me.
Yeah, it's kind of
stale cherry fruit leather.
Yeah,
it's not bad. Just
it has a consistency.
Stale
of
fruit leather.
Yeah.
Well, let's see this.
Just
this,
old fruit leather.
The whole
old.
Package, 50 cents.
Wow.
Canadian.
Wow.
So it has a kind of consistency of a really stale Eucharist.
What's a
stale
Eucharist?
Eucharist.
A stale
Eucharist is basically communion wafers.
Yeah.
Mm. Try
one day. Or I could not.
I could just not.
Unleavened bread.
Not bad.
Not bad.
Yeah.
Not bad.
Chalky, tasty,
so let's,
sweet.
Let's get our lesson of the week from Department of Justice. Do's and don'ts for kids.
Oh, God, no, please stop this!
It's funny. It's so hilarious. We have things to learn from the Department of Justice.
They like they're idiots.
they know about the internet, and they're willing to teach us.
Kids drive.
There's lots to learn here.
Say, did you know that Al Gore invented the internet?
He did.
There's an extensive article in Wired this coming month. The Wired magazine with the naked chick on the cover.
Okay.
That's the one that's got an extensive article with Al Gore. He's basically trying to explain what he meant by that I invented the internet article.
How can you get out of I invented the internet? How can you explain your way out of it?
He actually manages to weasel his way out of it.
Who's the name of the actual guy?
I don't understand. What are we talking about?
Al Gore said the vice president of the United States misspoke himself, basically. Not in those exact words, but...
said on Larry King Live that he invented the internet.
More or less, to the effect that he had invented the internet.
Why did he say that? What was his explanation for how
it had to do with? He wasn't saying that he invented it per se, but with the fact that he was the only person promoting it, and he was the kind of person with whom the idea was being disseminated in the corridors of power, that the internet could be something for the citizenry, for the masses.
For the masses.
He invented the concept of the internet for everybody.
Oh.
That was how.
So that common people. That's my favorite.
Well,
that's my favorite
to,
is when you get politicians using the word common as though.
That's my poor choice of words, not Al Gore's. Al Gore's
but politicians
Al
like to do that.
Worse.
You know, so that the common person can la 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 la.
He's just as usual one of the political people who's. Victim of foot and mouth disease.
Everybody's victim to that.
Well, let's face it, if I was on Larry King Live, I'd probably say some pretty damn stupid things too.
I wouldn't.
Also,
everything I would say would be brilliant.
Also known as the Gap-O-Matic candidate.
The only thing I would say if I ever managed to get on Larry King Live was bring me the head of John Bonnell.
That's all you needed to say.
The thing is, though, you've got Al Gore, but. Like, what are the alternatives? Like, oh, the Republicans! Oh,
actually,
yeah.
There's a Republican candidate I would almost vote for.
Keyword, almost.
Okay, but you know what? I don't even care. And it's not that it doesn't have any effect on me.
You should. I mean,
no,
you don't
no, I, no, because it's not like it doesn't have any effect on me. Sure, it does, because, you know, whatever. There would definitely be some effects. However, I'm a Canadian, and I didn't even vote, so I don't care.
Hey,
I'm not going to have any effect on it, whether it has an effect on me or
think,
not.
You don't think that 12, having basically Reagan and Bush in the office for 12 years didn't affect you as a Canadian?
I said it did. I said it will have an effect, but my point is that I have no effect on it. I do not get a vote.
Do you have any
So it doesn't matter whether I know.
Like, we over at the Peak, one of our editors is actually an American citizen, actually can vote in American elections. And, you know, it's kind of interesting the thought that, you know, if he actually casts a ballot, he wields the equivalent of how many Americans? So I just wonder about the calculation, considering how many Americans don't vote. If you actually cast a ballot, you're basically wielding the political power of how many Americans?
Well, remember, the President of the United States is elected by about 20% of the electorate.
Hmm.
There's about 40% actually vote in the election, and it's usually a fairly close split.
The last election we had up here in Canada, basically about, what was it, a week to the election?
Mm-hmm.
The NDP made the wonderful mistake of calling me up to ask for a polling.
Ah.
Oh boy.
What do you say to that?
Yeah, but you know what? If you really want to be on that poll, you have to just be against them, not psychotically against them. Because they take all the... theoretically, they take the...
top.
The top percentage and the bottom percentage.
Well,
and they
I spent a half an hour talking with this guy, and when I was done, he said that I was probably, he'd enjoyed talking to me more than anyone else. He had not laughed that much.
was he not an NDP supporter?
No, they're not going to, like, you're talking about the federal election?
Yeah.
They know they're not going to win. You know, they might as well just sit there and gab with somebody on the
phone.
So
who actually is basically in charge of it? Who's the Emperor's new clothes? I mean, what is it, Dushan or something like that? Who's currently in charge, or is there anybody in charge?
Of the MVP?
Yeah.
Who cares?
the only name that anybody can really remember is Sven Robinson.
Yeah. Exactly.
Can you kick Lieutenant Major Zombie off? Because he's interrupting with us, seeing any messages from, is it Infoloop?
Yes, Infoloop and Caffeine Honey.
Yeah, those guys, if they wanted to send us a message, we'd never see it because of Lieutenant Major Zombie.
He's doing one word per line. Lieutenant Major Zombie, that's bad.
Get a grip.
That's very, very
bad. You're a
bad
boy.
Bad.
I know we give you three.
Very bad.
I know the rule is we give you three strikes, but you've got about, what, 20?
Yeah,
20 of them there?
20 divided by 3. 6, a bit.
Sorry. Yeah, you're not sorry. We don't believe you.
I know it's
you're
bad.
Then why are you doing it? I know it's bad, but I can't help myself.
I'm a bad boy. Like,
anyways, let's...
I'm sorry, that's a Major Zombie, but if you do that again, we'll have to take you out and have you shot.
He's getting the attention he wants.
And not deserves. Yeah, we just... This is actually the last Department of Justice.
Yeah, number 5.
Yay. I got a copy of a really funny computer joke from my friend. It asks you if you want to internet access for free. When you say yes, it changes some files in your computer so that each time you log on, your computer says, "Way to go, Dodo. I think I'll send it to my friends as a joke." Let's see what they say about that.
Oh,
is that a thermal nuclear meltdown?
What should we do?
It's a melting computer.
Send
virus.
What
send
would
it
you
to
do?
Only...
Click on one of the following choices. A. Send it only to people you know really well who will know it's a joke. B. Use your friend's account to send it so no one will know that you sent it. C. Tell my friend not to send it to anyone. It could be a, quote, computer virus.
B. Finger everybody!
That's great. Use your friend's account.
Oh, it's the
unhappy
face.
You send the computer joke to all of your friends. Unfortunately, it's not a joke at all. It destroys the computer's hard drive.
Hard drive in quotes?
Wow. Hard drive. With a comma in the quotes, too. Which has copies of the How many copies of the operating system do they need? Copies of the operating system. And all personal files. It is very expensive and time-consuming to restore a hard drive. Everyone is really mad at your friend until they find out it's that you that sent the virus.
How? I'm not telling.
How did they know it? Oh, your friend's account. Okay. Yeah, you're not telling, eh?
Exactly. No, I got the virus too. That bastard. Let's go string him up.
And your friend is mad at you for using his account. Sending a computer virus through the internet is no joke. It's a crime.
It is a crime.
Oh, if you're unknowingly
you in serious on. Trouble, and you that might have to pay it. For the damage that you caused. Yeah, a 6-year-old child is going to like pay for computer repair bills.
Go after
sure.
their parents. Think about it.
I saw something, an ad this week. I could not believe it was for a Barbie.
Who's messing with the mic? Whoever it was, just stop.
It was for a Barbie or Hot Wheels computer.
Oh god, those have been out for like a month now. They're advertising
yeah.
them. It's,
one
they're,
for him, one for her.
That's a phenomenon that just drives me batty because the computers themselves are the same, but they come with different software packages. Now the Barbie one comes, of course, with you know an assortment of educational software and all the Barbie titles. The
but no math software.
Well,
it's too hard.
Just a calculator. Just a calculator.
You know the irony? Well, the thing
math
is the boys comes with Hot Wheels software and a bunch of educational software. But you know, there's an awful lot of Barbie software, so I guess they just had to knock a few of the educational titles off the roster, including a math package and a logic package. Ooh. Oh, well, you had to make room for Barbie nail designer, didn't you?
Well, that's what's
now,
important,
isn't it? The two computers come with, you know, like they come with different things. Like, you look at the two web pages, you know, the Hot Wheels is a powerful
I was only kidding about the math.
Family, and the Barbie computer is fun for your little girl. And, it's just bizarre because they have the Barbie computer comes with the little Barbie cam, like the little cheapy digital
That's
camera.
Right.
They've come out with a boys
what?
Version now.
Yeah.
Oh, so it's fair.
What about the steering wheel? Did the girls get a steering wheel?
No, there's no little pink steering wheel yet. Because little girls don't play games. No, they don't play games, you see. They play interactive interactive play experiences like Barbie Fashion Designer and Spice World. So
emotional learning tools.
Although you know, I was just in the store. Like I'm doing research on this for a paper I'm doing for school.
Yeah.
And like I'm in the store, and they've got like there's the girl like this Toys R Us. They got like the boys' software and the girls' software. They've got sort of general purpose educational software.
Yeah.
And so up on the wall, they got like the girls' software section is basically the Barbie section, right? It's this wall of you know retina searing pink. And the next one is the section of all, you know, sort of like red and green and purple boys soccer. And the girl section, like, I see this little girl go up with her dad, you know, this little cute, sweet little girl and her dad who's like this
field research you're doing here.
You know, it's this guy who looks like a plumber, I don't know. This typical plumber looking guy. And the little girl goes right for the Barbie software, grabs the Barbie camera, brings over and starts like shoves it like right like attempts to shove it up her dad's right nostril. Her dad will not even turn his head. No, dear, that's too expensive. Instead, he grabs the Nick Cam, which is basically the exact same camera except purple and with package. On the package, it has boys on it.
Oh, wow.
Same price. Yeah. But there isn't even a price listed on the thing. But he grabs that one.
Yeah.
And that's the one he's going to get. For his little girl. And the little girl's sort of looking up, you know, he just sort of orders her to put the girl one, the pink one back. I guess because you know, the pink one threatens his masculinity when he touches
the
it. The little girl's sort of looking at it, you know, sort of, he can just see the wheels turning, thinking, you know, if I say I don't want to get that one, I'm not going to get a damn camera. Oh.
That's right.
I like that one better anyways. Yeah. Headed straight for the till. The guy didn't even know what the price was on. That was the sad part because he wouldn't look at the girls. He wouldn't look
really?
At the girls' version. But he and the boys' one didn't have the price tag listed. He didn't even care what the price was. He just didn't want to touch the pink thing. Oh, welcome to Langland.
Dipshit sent this in last week. A gross hospital story. A girl came into the hospital complaining that a bug had crawled into her ear while she was asleep. I'll make it to make a long story short. A roach crawled into her ear and died. Imagine a fucking roach crawling into your ear. Fucking gross.
Actually, those are common, aren't
yeah,
they?
Yeah, like, it's very, very common.
Why would a roach go into your ear?
Actually,
because the roaches go into the warm place, and not only that.
Warm, moist.
It's warm, moist, and also you're thinking of large, basically brown cockroaches.
Yeah.
What are called German cockroaches. Actually, no, that's not German cockroach. I can't remember the name of that species.
Yeah.
The more common one that I saw
it's
a lot
really
more in New
weird.
York. Is basically about maybe a half an inch long and maybe only about a quarter of an inch wide at the thickest for the largest of them.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what probably crawled into her ear.
And they commonly die in your ear?
No, well, basically, they go into your ear, and you basically, of course, freak out and shove your finger in there.
Right.
Not only crushing the animal, but shoving it deeper into your ear canal. Not only that, you have wax in your ear, which acts like a nice glue, along with the roach's innards. And the real problem from all of that is, besides having a dead insect now in your ear, is the fact
that's
that...
That's not the real problem, is it?
No, it isn't. The inside of the digestive tract of a cockroach is the most foul, disgusting, germ-laden place on the face of the earth, minus a human being's mouth.
Mm, guaranteed infection, then.
Guaranteed an inner ear infection.
Well, ooh. You know, I remember reading like a medical report describing how they found that they'd actually found this, that some specific chemical compound. They could just take like a swab dipped in this fairly common compound which is used for treating some other skin condition or something.
Mm-hmm.
If they bring it up close to the ear, the cockroach will like jump out of the ear. Like I remember hearing like the first time they tried this was on a woman who actually somehow managed to get a cockroach in either ear. And they did this as a scientific test. They tried one method, one ear, they did with the sort of squirting water into it, which is the typical
syringe.
Thing. The syringe full of water sort
yeah.
of flushed out the cockroach. The other side they did with, they just brought this swab up. Before they even got it anywhere near the ear, the cockroach bolted out of the ear and a nurse dispatched it with her shoe as it ran across the floor.
Okay. So this stuff is nasty, or
it's like a scientific, you know, it's a scientific.
Cockroaches must be really, really, really stupid then. Okay. There's really, really smelly bad thing over here. I'm going to run at it.
No, basically the scent is going in there so the animal panics, and a cockroach's nervous system works so that when it panics, the legs automatically start running. You ever wonder why a cockroach is so hard to step on? It's because the minute you turn the light on, It's not the brain saying, I have to get the fuck out of here. Its nervous system is hardwired, so when it panics, it immediately starts running.
I'm like, wow, I'm moving!
So it's like you're in a car and the gas pedal's stuck, you're just steering.
Yeah, exactly. I fortunately have not seen a cockroach since I left New York, and I hope to keep it that way. Though
I would move as soon as I see them. After hearing that story, I would
there,
move
they
the first
are
sight of a cockroach in my apartment.
There are apparently cockroaches now.
Maybe you really should,
if
you're really concerned about cockroaches, maybe you should really clean this carpet for like the first time since you moved in, because there's like, there's
it's
probably...
It's filthy right now. I do vacuum it. I just didn't vacuum it this week.
Probably
I usually vacuum it right after the show.
I wouldn't be surprised if there's still chinchilla crap buried underneath the layers.
Guaranteed. There's chinchilla crap inside that couch. They got inside the couch, as did the dogs.
If we took
the couch up and shook it, there'd be lots of stuff coming out.
Talking about small animals. And
we don't really need to know this.
And you know what I found?
No! Confirmed. No, I don't want to know!
A year and a half.
Or 2 years.
So, I found these.
What are they?
Chew bones.
In that chair.
Hard rubber chew bones?
You have a chihuahua.
Yeah,
chihuahua sized.
Actually... Yeah,
so it says smooth, regular, and that's like the kinky spine.
Chihuahua.
So it,
I buy a
so
rawhide
like,
one that's
like
this big and they're
gone crunchy.
In like a week and a half.
I'm not touching those things.
It's like a chipper.
They have this special
one. You got
one.
A chihuahua?
Yeah.
Ah,
they're
see,
awesome.
Yeah.
Like a Taco Bell
package
chihuahua?
Oh, she's black and tan and cute. I do not like chihuahuas.
The friendliest dog, one of the friendliest dogs I ever met was a chihuahua. A little white albino chihuahua. You wouldn't think the chihuahuas would be like friendly and mellow, but this one was.
Well, it's friendly and mellow.
Oh, yeah.
It was well, when it first sees you, it'll
freak
it. It'll go like, no, it goes, who's this, and goes for you.
Okay, so what you're saying is it's mellow for a chihuahua, but it's not actually mellow.
It's mellow.
No, it's not mellow.
Do you
because
know
if your dog freaks out and goes crazy, it's
all
not
dogs,
mellow.
All
do you know where
chihuahuas
all dogs
do
don't
do that.
No,
all
that's not true.
Do you know where chihuahuas came from?
Chihuahua, Mexico?
No. Basically, after World War II, a Nazi scientist experimenting down in South America, crossbreeding rat with a piranha fish, and came up with the chihuahua.
Seems that way, doesn't it?
All right.
There's a joke I ran across on the internet. It's called Groan of the Day. A rich bloke decided to have himself cloned. After a long and expensive development process, a clone was created and specially matured. Unsurprisingly, it turned out to be an exact physical duplicate of the man. Mentally, however, something went wrong, and all the clone could do was spew forth the most vile language and filthy profanities. After a couple of weeks of putting up with this torrent and trying to find out if the clone could respond or somehow healed or repaired, the bloke decided to cut his losses. He took the clone up into the mountains, went to the edge of a steep cliff, and pushed the clone over the edge. A policeman popped out from behind a tree and said, "I'm afraid you're under arrest, sir. I'm going to have to ask you to come with me." The bloke sighed, "Look, officer, it isn't what it looks like. I didn't murder anyone. That wasn't a real person." The officer shook his head, "I didn't say anything about murder, sir. I'm arresting you for making an obscene clone fall."
I refuse to groan. I refuse to groan.
So bad.
I refuse
that's
to give up a groan for that.
Obscene clone fall. That's for those who missed.
Bang your head against the wall material. Totally.
Why? Why waste effort thinking about it and blanking
Drex
it from my mind?
Like,
speechless.
Yeah.
I told you earlier my brain was hurting. Right? You're not helping.
Isn't that bad? This is from Drex, so he can read this one.
LA terms are
no, it's not. Part. I don't send you anything. Every
you
week.
You sent this in email. I have it in email. I have proof in my computer.
Oh, yes. Okay, I remember this one. But every week he goes, "I think this was something you sent me, right?" And I'm like, "No, it isn't."
I just put
this
right as a default if I can't remember the name.
Okay, this is from an article from the LA Times. Actually, the funny thing is that Corey told me about this a long time ago, and someone he sent
probably
some
urban.
Oh, is this the? Is this the?
No, it's not an urban myth.
Okay.
Okay.
And this actually, as a side note, this is a cartoon at the Second Twisted.
Yes.
I haven't seen the Second Twisted yet.
Is this the story of the gerbil cannon?
Or Or we could just have Dak tell what happens in it right off the bat, because he's gotta let us all know that he knows what's going on.
Let's work backwards with the story.
Yeah, we'll just start with the end of it. And
I just asked if this was...
Yeah, but you know what? You could have not asked what it was. Like, is this the movie where everyone dies in the end and the heroes all get their balls cut off?
Can I tell you something? If it is, and apparently it is, I don't feel bad for ruining it, because this is disgusting, cruel, sick.
Oh, disgusting, cruel, sick from Gross Hospital Story Man. Coming from the man that tells us about a guy cutting through his testicles with a pair of scissors. And I'm supposed to be feeling sorry for you know, making you think of something nasty.
Because that was a human being. This is a poor, defenseless animal.
Can we actually tell a story here?
All right. Okay. And I'm just going to read what it says here.
Okay.
Okay.
Don't ad-lib. Nope. No knife.
It's easier to take out than just put away. In retrospect, lighting the match was my big mistake. gotta get closer. But I was only trying to retrieve the gerbil, Eric told bemused doctors in the severe burn unit of Salt Lake City Hospital. Eric and his homosexual partner, Andrew Kiki, had been admitted for emergency treatment after a fletching session had gone seriously, wrong. I pushed a cardboard tube up his rectum and slipped Raggett, our gerbil, in, he explained. As usual, Kiki shouted, Armageddon, my kid, they ain't had enough.
As usual.
I tried to retrieve Raggett, but he wouldn't come out again, so I peered into the tube and struck a match, thinking the light might attract him.
Which way was the gerbil facing?
At a hushed press conference, a hospital spokesman described what happened next.
Turning around.
The match ignited a pocket of intestinal gas, and a flame shot out of the tubing, igniting Mr. Eric's hair and severely burning his face. It also set fire to the gerbil's fur and whiskers, which in turn ignited a larger pocket of gas further up the intestine, propelling the rodent out like a cannonball. Eric suffered second-degree burns and broken nose from the impact of the gerbil, while... What's the other guy's? Kiki. suffered first and second degree burns to his anus and lower intestinal tract. And then at this, here he has top 9 scariest things about this story. Number 9 is, I pushed a cardboard tube up his rectum.
Number 8, so I peered into the tube, I'm sorry, but that's like looking through a telescope into hell. I don't use binoculars to stare at the sun.
Number 7, that poor gerbil, who obviously suffers from low self-esteem, being shot at the guy's ass, like Rocky the Flying Squirrel,
Rocky
and Bullwinkle.
Number 6, suffering a broken nose from a gerbil being launched out of someone's anus. I'm guessing, but I seriously doubt the gerbil was springtime fresh after his journey into Kiki's Tunnel of Love.
Wow, Tunnel of Love, that's great. Number 5, people walking around with these volcanic-like buckets of gas in their rectums.
Number 4, people who do this kind of thing and then admit that they were doing it when taken to the emergency room. Sorry, but I think I would have made up a story about a gang of roving pyromaniac anal sex fiends breaking into my house and sodomizing me with a charcoal lighter floor before admitting the truth. Call me old-fashioned, but I just can't imagine looking at a doctor and saying, well, Doc, it's like this. You see, we have this gerbil named Raggett, and we took a cardboard tube.
Number 3. First and second degree burns to the anus. Wouldn't this make the burning itch and discomfort of hemorrhoids relief? How does one ever take a healthy dump after something like this? And the smell of burning anus might be in the top 5 most horrible things on the face of God's green earth.
Number 2, people named Kiki, which is obviously a Polynesian word for idiot white men who insert rodents up their butts.
Number 1, what kind of hospital would hold a press conference on this?
They didn't say it was in Salt Lake City.
I see.
I remember reading a Savage Love column. The guy was completely debunking the possibility of you know, how could somebody put a cardboard tube up their rectum? Never mind the gerbil.
Oh, yes.
Not going to go there.
We could go further with that.
But I suggest we don't.
Yes, yes, yes. No. We are in complete agreement. No argument here. Ever.
Go down that road.
Yeah. Something I've got here called the stupid
It's a subject
page.
That perhaps somebody could research, and then when we find out, we kill them. We've done the research.
I sent you that one.
I think so. It's called the stupid page.
A while ago.
Yeah. Let's do start from the top. Stupid people. Actually,
there's some good ones.
We better do gross hospital stories.
There's gross hospital like stories. Oh, okay.
I'll keep up the intro. While I waste time. Wasting time. Here we go.
Yeah.
Okay, never mind.
I was gonna say, why are you bothering? Because no one can see it anyways, but...
No, it's for the...
But for the video, I guess.
Okay.
Well, hello boys and girls. This week, our story contains everything. Self-humiliation, pain, grossness, and the second largest needle I've ever seen.
Is the largest needle you've ever seen in another story?
No, the largest needle I've ever seen had to do with something that wasn't so gross. It's a pericardial needle. The idea is it's supposed to puncture through the chest, through the sternum, through the pericardial sac, which is the tissue that covers your heart, that separates your heart from your lungs.
That's the thing in Pulp Fiction?
You know, I think actually, yeah.
Stab! It's got to go through.
Yes, by the way, you do not use a pericardial needle that way. You slip it between the cartilage that is attached to your sternum and your ribs.
Yeah.
This story starts when a man about 34 years old was brought into the hospital completely, well, he's not really unconscious because he was responsive in the fact that he was moving and was twitching and actually he was delirious when he was brought in. He was, however, not responding to any verbal communication. He was not responding to any type of normal responses other than simple pain or pain stimulus. That's where you take that's where you take a needle and you poke him in the foot and he would try to pull his foot away. He was running a fever, I think, of about 105 when we got him.
Mm-hmm.
So they start trying to lower his body temperature by doing an IV push with cooled saline.
Mm-hmm.
That's where they take saline that has a lower temperature than the body temperature, and they just basically put it into an IV. Real simple. Anyhow, this goes on for a few hours. They try everything they can to get a response out of this guy, and they try Narcan, because maybe it's like drugs, no problems. They do put a catheter in, check for basically... By the way, the catheter comes in later. I'm curious about something I've never been able to get an answer for.
Uh-huh.
They place a catheter in, they check his urine, find out if maybe it's diabetes.
Barbed wire?
No, it's not diabetes. This guy's having...
Barbed wire catheter?
Barbed wire catheter.
Having, it's like none of the normal responses that they can think of. So we have this guy for a few hours. Now he's rolling and thrashing so bad that we've had to strap him and restrain him to the bed. But he's so big that if you leave him unattended for more than a few minutes, he's actually able to pull through the restraints.
Wow.
Well, no, because we're not able to use like leather straps in this type of situation. All it is a vest, which basically crosses over the ties to the bed, and a pair of like just simple cloth restraints that you tie around the person's wrist to tie his hands down.
Mm-hmm.
I'm pretty sure Enki could come up with something better.
Probably.
But,
I'm pretty sure Enki has come up with something.
Yes.
Haven't you seen his
restraints? Yes, I have. Okay.
Don't tell me these things. I don't need to know.
So anyhow, the way it was, we had to sit on this guy for hours.
Uh-huh.
That's where you literally stand by his bed and just simply make sure he doesn't actually get up or pull any of his IV tubes out or anything. So they finally decide to transfer him into the recess room from the stretcher where we had him in just the standard emergency bay and start checking out different things. Now in doing so, he rolls over and pukes all over my shoes. It's not that bad. I had that happen so many times, I don't want to talk about it. So, finally, after hours and hours of doing this, the doctor decides to test for something. He wants to find out if this man has meningitis. Mm-hmm. Now, meningitis is either a bacteria or viral infection which causes the spinal column and the tissue covering the spinal column and the tissue covering the brain to swell. Mm-hmm. This would cause all the responses that we had seen.
Uh-huh.
There's one problem. If it's bacterial meningitis, that's fine, because you can only pick that up if you ingest it or get an infection yourself. So it's very hard to actually pick up an infection like this.
Yeah.
If it's viral meningitis, from our close contact with this man, including the part where he puked on my shoes,
be good enough,
we get to go into quarantine.
And possibly...
and could possibly get meningitis ourselves,
and
which basically something like one in about 10 people who gets meningitis dies.
There's a 10 sided die for you.
Yeah. we're all feeling really, really good about this, and it decides it's now time to basically test him. To do this, they have to do a spinal tap. Now, when a person is conscious for a spinal tap, you lay down on your side, allow the doctor to place a needle that's about 3.5 inches long into your spinal column by slipping it through the cartilage in between a couple of your vertebrae. Yep. And if it's okay, the doctor will then draw back a small sample of fluid, which will come out clear. Like almost a very viscous liquid.
Yep.
Okay.
Very simple. Easy to do, except for it's very painful. But when a person is not responsive, what you have to do is you have to bunch his legs up to his chest, like a fetal position, and hold them there.
Okay.
Which means that I have to then lay across this man's entire body, cramping onto his legs, and holding him down. Now, remember I mentioned the catheter? At some point when they transferred him from the standard emergency bay to our recess room, someone felt the need to remove the catheter. And then basically place him on the bed. No catheter, so he's free and just flowing in the wind, except for with his little hospital gurney on. Jersey, whatever you want to call it. So I lay across his legs because I'm the only one who's big enough.
I'm stupid, I guess. What's a catheter?
A catheter is a tube that they place in through the urinary tract, through your penis or through the urinary tract of a woman's vagina, all the way down into your bladder. All the way to your bladder so that when you need to go to the bathroom, it just transfers the liquid.
I get it. I understand.
So they decided to remove the catheter. So he lands on the bed, I bunch his legs up, which he's kicking and struggling, by the way, and he's a big boy. I'm holding on as tight as I can for dear life. The doctor sticks the needle in, and of course, what does he do? His bladder lets go. Now, the normal response would be to let go and jump away, right? But I can't, because if we do, and he thrashes, the needle could then jab into some part of his spine, paralyzing him. So I have to lay there and hold on to this guy while he's urinating all over my chest, lap, and legs.
At least he didn't get in your face.
No. Okay, now here's the other gross part. I get to watch a 3-inch needle sticking into this guy's spine. Now remember I said how the fluid is supposed to come out?
Oh, no.
He has meningitis so bad, the fluid squirts out under its own pressure into the tube, and it's milky. The doctor had never, in 27 years of practicing medicine, he had never seen that contaminated a sample, ever.
Wow, did he die?
Just wait. So, he takes the sample, sends it down to the lab. I'm supposed to go home now, but I can't because we have to wait for the test to come back because if it's viral meningitis, I'm going into quarantine.
Where you just stay covered in urine.
So I go downstairs, grab a shower, take my uniform, dump it. I'm waiting. Finally, it comes back. It only turns out to be bacterial meningitis.
Okay.
Our boy went up to the CCU, that's critical care unit, where he stayed for 24 hours, at which point his temperature continued to rise despite their best ability to try and lower it. He got to 109 before he passed away.
Wow. Nasty.
They never found the source of the meningitis.
Then there's the capper that Dak forgot to mention, because I remember when this story happened, because he told me about it after it happened. This all happened over the Christmas and New Year's period.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah. Yeah, it was a
Christmas present.
Right around that time. Also, the one good thing that did happen was my supervisor had shown up. Now, we referred to this man as Buster the Body Crab because he was an annoying itch you couldn't scratch. He was such a poser that we don't even want to go into it. He's currently working for CNN Railway as one of their police officers or whatever you call CNN rail cop.
Railroad dick.
Yeah, railroad dick is a good word for him. And this complete and utter loser, upon finding out that we might be quarantined, was flipping out. The rest of us were kind of like, gee, this really sucks. Welcome to this job. And he's like losing it. He's spazzing because he just came in to basically help us because he wanted to be a big guy. Uh-huh. And, you know, oh, I can help out. I don't need any help. He just said, yes, you do. So that's my gross story for the week.
That was pretty nasty.
It wasn't really that gross.
It was pretty gross to me anyway.
It took him that long to figure it might be meningitis.
He didn't have any other signs. It was basically, there was no samples. We just literally got this guy unconscious with a high fever and no other signs. It was a massive, basically, infection. So it was running like wildfire through this guy's system.
Time for the show to end.
That was a fast one, so thank you.
Yeah, it was very fast, actually.
Wow.
No, it's 11. No phone in. We filled up the time.
And nobody's listening because...
There are six people listening right now.
Because of technical difficulties.
We have six people?
Right now. So it might hit a peak of 8 or 10, maybe.
Which one's... What server's down?
T3 is, like, solid. That one's always up. But they have to connect to the IP address, so they can't type in the normal T3 Sonic crap, right? And
nobody can go to the Shoutcast page?
Yes, because that's based on IPs, but I don't know if they do or know about that or anything like that. But it's time for the show to end, so we're going to say bye to Caffeine High, Infaloop, and Lieutenant Major Zombie, who managed to make it into the IRC channel.
By the way, that was not projectile vomit, man. That was
DJ Psycho. And so we'll go around the room and say bye from left.
Bye from the girl on the left.
No, I don't
want to
do it.
Project out on it, man.
Goodbye.
I don't think we've ever had that.
No, I don't think
has
so.
He ever done that? Goodbye.
That's
no, he spoke. That's a
he
new
spoke.
One.
Yeah, I did. Goodbye from Dak. Bye.
Yeah, boy.
Yeah, bye.
You have to say your names.
It still feels like I have snot in my nose.
We needed to know that.
We don't need
Drex to say his name. Everybody knows by his running commentary.
Lieutenant
Major Zombie wants to say bye to, I think.
Hi, welcome to Rant Radio. Who is this?
Whoever they want.
I guess they had nothing to say, and they figured I'd hang up on them, so they.
My joke's on them. I paid 10 to 25 cents.
I think what they did is they just hung up on us for a change.
Wrong number.
Or somebody
could be.
Somebody
not expecting that.
Yeah.
What?
Well, that's too bad for them. So this is us saying bye, and this is me putting on the outro music until next week at 9 p.m. Sunday night. That's right.
Can I just see what Lieutenant Major Zombie was saying to me?
Sure.
Bye, girl on the left. That is sexy looking.
He's a guaranteed
ESL
graduate.
One of our southern armadillers.
We're impossible.
He's not an ESL graduate. He's just an idiot. He's still in
What? This is not going to end after 1 week. I'm pretty sure.
Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that because Lieutenant Major Zombie's an idiot that means you're not sexy.
Oh.
You're a fine, sexy woman. It's just that.
It's just that.
That he
like,
is an idiot.
I saw his.
You sent you back.
I sent you an. James, I sent you an email.
Yep.
And it had a. It was. What it had on it was it had some links to. It was a poster sent. It was this online sort of curriculum for teaching about piracy, software piracy for kids.
Oh, yeah.
It was done by in cooperation with Business Software Alliance, which is the big anti-piracy.
You ready?
Anytime, tell me.
Just a second.
And they also had and Scholastic, who actually make.
I think that's good.
It was this poster for their thing.